sing. It's yours to hold. Be still and know that even when you're lost in
We say thank you to Sister Janibel for blessing us again with special music this Sabbath morning. All our praise people and the musicians. We also say thank you to for nurturing us through this service today. Hebrews chapter 6, we have reflected on its reading already. It says, therefore, leaving the discussion of elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God, of the doctrine of baptism, of laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. This we will do, if God permits. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance, since they crucify again for themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame. Dear God of heaven, we bring before you this congregation again. We ask for your special presence with us today, and we lift before you the sick of our congregation. We hold before you Sister Donna, and we pray your special blessings upon her. We hold before you Sister Stella, and we ask for your blessings upon her. We hold before you Sister Smith Senior, we ask your special blessing upon her. We hold before you those of our saints who are away from this building today. We ask for your special blessings upon them. We hold before you this nation, and we ask your special blessings upon us. We hold before you Sister Angela and her son and daughter-in-law and the family circle, and we ask for your healing hands through this grieving process in their lives. We thank you, Lord, for your willingness to do that. And so this week, today, we hold before you Ken and Cheryl and Kendra and Laura Shea. We ask your special blessings upon them. It is your touch and your special presence, your capacity to attend to our every need, we celebrate, and we pray that you might be with us all. And so now, please let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen and amen. And so the story begins. The Apostle Paul has been writing, and he speaks of important things in the spiritual maturing of people. And as he speaks here, we get to the 12th verse in the division we call chapter 5, before the author says, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, and you need someone to teach you again the first principles and oracles of God, you have come to need milk, not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." Paul speaks of a growth that is expected in the Christian. And so it is in that context, having laid that argument out, he said, "Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on unto perfection," not laying again the foundation. And so this brings me to the first observation that I want to make today. It's about building upon the foundation which has been laid. It seems to me as if the Apostle Paul is saying here, a foundation is futile without a completion of the desired structure. A foundation is futile, he's saying, if the desired structure is not laid on it. So, in other words, laying the foundation is not the same as completing the building. Laying the foundation is not the same as completing the building. Notice how he argues here. He says, having laid the foundation, let us go on unto perfection. My sister lived at a place in Brooklyn there, and I would go in to visit every now and then. She has not long moved from that place. But while living there, there is an open lot, expensive land in Brooklyn. There's an open lot that runs from one street all across to the other. And this particular lot, suddenly people showed up to start building something. I made funny comments about the builders because I've been exposed to construction a little bit, and I'm always drawn to observing people as they do their building. This builder didn't appear to be very astute or very dedicated to the work, but he was building. And I watched, they dug and they dug and they dug, and they started to build and they laid a foundation. I'll make comments, so they would almost look forward to me coming to make comments about this builder laying the foundation. It's gone to almost 10 years now since this builder started building. And the last time I went into the city at that spot, the foundation was all that was there. Nothing was placed on the foundation. Just rust, weeds, disruption of the neighbors' lives. I saw to the neighborhood and within the neighborhood. It's worth nothing. It's just the foundation left there. Nothing. The Apostle Paul says, we need to leave the elementary principles behind. So let's go on unto perfection. It is from the Greek teleos, which literally means come to maturity. It's used twice in the New Testament here and in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 14. He says, let's go on to complete the structure. What have you got? He says, you've been laying down foundations. Repentance from dead works. He names six things. Repentance from dead works. Dead. Nekron are gone from the Greek nekros. Dead works, repentance. Robertson thought that this refers to the deadening power of sin. You have repented from that. You have that initial faith towards God of which this book spends a lot of time talking about. You have the baptism already in which you were supposed to have gone down with Christ in baptism and become dead to the things of the flesh and resurrected to walk in the newness of life. You understand the laying on of hands, the symbol of blessing, the resurrection of the dead. You understand that concept, Paul, the author here is saying. And you understand the concept of eternal judgment. These things all you understand. Why are you just circling around here on these elementary principles and not growing to maturity? Laying a foundation is futile unless the structure which should be built on it is completed. Laying the foundation is not the same as completing the building. I thought about this as we reflected as stewards throughout this period. And in my opinion, the author's letter in Hebrews here is probably appropriate for us also. No Christian is making the impact that God wants him or her to make, if he or she is just circling around, laying foundations, but not completing the structure. What are you doing, Horatius? The apostle says here it is important for us to understand completion, not just laying foundation. There are many Christians, if they would be faithful to God to testify, they would turn to God and ask him to move them out of the static, stationary type of experience and seek for him to bring an enhancement of development so that not just foundation can be seen, an eyesore to the neighborhood, rust and weed, and nothing that is profitable, but to become complete structures. That's what God wants of us. Laying the foundation is only futile if the complete structure is not accomplished. Laying the foundation is not the same as building a complete building. I used to live in a community where we traveled by great waterways sometimes. And this whole concept of perfection, I think now, was somewhat illustrated as we traveled. I used to be in my youthful days, my childhood days, I always looked way ahead, and it looks as if the skyline and the waterway connected. Later on, I learned the term horizon. But as we traveled, I'm always eager to meet the horizon. I wanted to be able to touch it. I wanted to be able to experience, to be right there where the skyline touched the waterway. We traveled, but I've never been able to meet the horizon. Never been able to touch it. The Christian experience in growth, in going towards perfection, is like unto chasing the horizon. There is something in the experience that is complete, while the experience is still incomplete. Am I making sense? We are reaching where God would have us be at a certain time. That is the experience of the completion. That is salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. That is the connection with Jesus. That is the declaration of at the throne of grace that a person is righteous. That's the point when a person is taken by God, and in the process of being sanctified, the person is in the process of being sanctified, set aside for holy use. And what the person's experiencing is a transformation of character, a development of life by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, which is never static. It's complete, but still incomplete. And every Christian needs to have that understanding of his or her experience. Maturity. Maturity is literally, by grace through faith, being all that God wants us to be at a certain time in our experience. And that's a transaction between a person and God. But I know that transaction can become a static transaction where the person is slipping. The reason I know is because it's a biblical reality as stated here by this writer here in Hebrews chapter 6. Having laid the foundation, you should be going on to perfection. You're still back in the old days. You're just using milk and not reaching the maturity where you're able to consume solid food. That's what he's saying. And I'm saying that's a biblical reality. And I ought to have my head in Christ checked so that I have not become a victim of this tactic that the apostle is here condemning. Laying the foundation is futile without the completion of the structure, the desired structure. Laying the foundation is not the same as completing the building. And so he says here, verse 4 says, "For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have become partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come," that is the powers of eternity in Jesus Christ. This is what folks used to refer to as inaugurated and consummated eschatology. Folks say when Christ came to the planet, he brought the powers of the future age and made it available to the children of God so that as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons and daughters of God. That is the power of Christ in the present age. The power of the future age has invaded time and come into our lives. And when that power enters our lives, the apostle is saying here, you have tested the power of the age to come. And because we have tested that power, something has been inaugurated in our lives. The kingdom of God has begun in our lives, and that kingdom is supposed to grow so that we can say with meaning, as you said, the kingdom of God is within you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And that kingdom within you is supposed to mature until it is consummated when Jesus Christ comes the second time. We are as much as God would have us be. We are perfected in Christ. So he said, you've tasted all of that. Taste the age to come. And then you fall away. He said, if they fall away, the impossible, the antecedent to, for it is impossible, the antecedent to that is now this. If they fall away, it is impossible for them to renew again repentance. I read this thing and it caused me to struggle a little bit this week. And so this brings me to the second observation of the day. The incompletion of the structure. Or we might say the stagnation of the process makes one vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. The stagnation of the process or the incompletion of the structure makes one vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. He is saying when this stagnation, which is alluded to in chapter 5 from verse 12 and onwards, and in chapter 6 here at the beginning, let us go on unto perfection. If that progress is stalled, if it stays incomplete and stagnant for too long, a soul becomes vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. Trust me, nobody likes to linger on these passages. I have wrestled with this one and the one in Romans chapter 10 because the Apostle Paul talks the same thing in other places. He says it's like a dog returning to its own vomit. That's how he talks about it. And what he's dealing with is a specific reality. That reality is about souls who have come to know about Christ. And having known about Christ, they become careless with that religious experience. And that carelessness with the religious experience results in them developing a laissez-faire attitude. and the operationalization of that laissez-faire religiosity is a person who is an I don't care Christian. I'll show up when I show up. I do what I feel like. I'll just linger along the fringes, and they may talk to me, but I don't care much what they say. It's between me and Jesus. Yes, it is between you and Jesus. And if it was between Horatius and Jesus, he would seek to make it what Jesus wants it to be by the grace of Jesus Christ and the power of Christ. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying. And if you linger there too long, you are exposing yourself to certain vulnerability to an ultimate erosion of faith. Are you all hearing me? Because what the apostle is saying here, what the writer is saying here is a very important thing. And it probably is important because it's in the Bible. Why is it important? The apostle is writing and he's talking about the ultimate falling away, which is possible for those who have not allowed themselves to be subject to the grace of God to move on to perfection. The incompletion of the structure makes a person vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. Enlightened. Once enlightened. Photizo, from the gnon, the Greek phos, light. John talks in 1:9 about the light, which gives light. That is Jesus who gives light to everyone who comes into the world. That is it. Ephesians 1:18 says, your eyes being enlightened. Hebrews 10:32 says, recall the former days after you were illuminated. All the same root word, enlightened. Receiving the light. You tasted the heavenly gift. Partakers of the Holy Spirit. Tasted the good word of God. Experienced the powers of the age to come. All these things happened. And the apostle is saying that people who experience all these things still can fall away. Why? Because they neglected the opportunity to complete the structure. The perfection never came. They were never complete, just incomplete. But he says here, listen. That situation has a terrible, terrible, terrible consequence. It's impossible for them to experience this new life again. I have pondered about this. Jesus talks a little bit about this in Matthew. Chapter 12, he talked an interesting story about a demon being cast out from a person. He went his way. The demon went. And that soul just lay there, empty, unfilled with the Holy Spirit. Demon walks the waste places of the land, found no port to embed its evil self, and he returns, the demon. It's analogous to this. A man walks down the street, he's drunk, he's shaking, he's all messy. He can't do any harm to people. Everybody detests him. And he hears the preaching and he walks into some church. He comes there, he sits at the back, and the Holy Ghost speaks his mind. In his inebriated state, he's managing to make sense of the words, and he understands by grace through faith in Jesus Christ you're saved. Right now he hears that. He said, I want that. Preacher makes the appeal and invites him up. He staggers to the front and he is so smelly. people move aside. Some loving soul carouses him and encourages him, and he says, I want that salvation. He's saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. So next few months he's cleaned. He smells better. Can even smell the cleanness. He's washed. He's been lifted from the miry clay. His feet are now planted on the solid rock. Smells clean. The old tight commercial used to say he's so clean, you can even smell the cleanness. Febreze, yeah. And so he gets stagnant. The mind is changed. The synapses are new wiring happens. He has no love, no taste for liquor anymore, but he got stagnated. Stagnated. His growth ceases to be. The heavenly gift that he tasted, the partake of the Holy Spirit, the good word of God, the experience of the powers of the age to come, these are all now stagnated within his soul. But he's not going back to drinking. He's become a fit vessel in the household of faith for powerful temptation for him to terrorize God's people. The spirit, that evil one who walks up and down, he comes back and he makes an attempt to enter his old house, this evil spirit. He finds it vacant. Vacant. Why is it vacant? Because this soul has not allowed himself or herself to be filled with the Spirit of God, to engage in the growth to perfection, the imperfection. The incompletion of the structure makes this person vulnerable to ultimate loss of faith. He finds his place vacant and he enters. The place is so nice now. A drunkard in the hand of the devil is not as powerful a tempter as a sober person in the hands of the devil. A drunkard in the hands of the devil outside of the church is not as powerful in the hands of the devil as a drunkard inside the church. But now he's clean. He's sober. He has a clear mind. He can make arguments when you hear him speak. The forked tongue can be deceptive. It's a sober person in the hands of the devil. Says, I need 7 more like myself. The last state of the person is worse than the first. Are you hearing me? Incompletion of the structure makes one vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. That's what we have. And so the apostle says, right here says, I say, first of all, foundation is futile without a completion of the desired structure. Laying the foundation is not the same as completing the building. The incompletion of the structure makes one vulnerable to an ultimate erosion of faith. Jesus said he comes back and he brings 7 like himself, and he's now sitting pretty in the household of God, an agent in the hands of the devil. Nobody knows it. But the enemy knows. The enemy knows. And so, brothers and sisters, I'm saying here, Jesus said, when such falls away, he said, that falling away is like crucifying the Son of God afresh and bringing him to open shame. That's what it is. Bring bringing him to open shame. So I want to suggest here to stay this state and to enhance the development. There are three things which are necessary. The Bible seems to be consistent. The first thing is in building the faith is what we often refer to as prayer. Prayer, prayer, prayer. The thing in the hands of the saint that opens heaven's storehouse, prayer. Jesus showed us this in Mark 1:35. In the morning, rising up a great while before they are, whatever time one is able to do it, just for us to get that in. He went out into a solitary place and there he prayed. It's the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. It's presenting to God our needs, our concerns, and having Jesus work in our souls. Prayer. Prayer. The next thing is Bible study. Just a reflection on the Word of God, whether it be through reflecting on the Sabbath school lesson, and beyond that, reading the Bible for ourselves and finding inspiration there. As we read whatever we are able to read, whatever we have the discipline to read, to just be there and linger there, and you ask God to let the Spirit, which was so powerful in the saints of old, to be powerful in our lives. The Bible study keeps us anchored. It keeps us remembering, oh, God can do this for me as he did for the saints in days of old. The Bible study, prayer, Bible study. Bible study. Bible study warms the heart and makes the soul ready. Two souls were traveling to Emmaus and somebody joined them and walked along the way. And the Bible said he opened unto them the scriptures. And when they reached the house, they asked him to come in. And when he lifted his hands to pray on the bread, they saw the nail piercing and they recognized it was Jesus. Jesus was there coming through to their minds as the word was open to them. And when he left, they said, did not our hearts burn within us? He opened to us the word of God. Bible study makes souls connected to God and to his work. The study of the word. So we have prayer and Bible study. How are we going to build this thing in allowing God to speak to us and to communicate to us through the Bible and through prayer? And the next thing is witnessing. Witnessing. The falling away is helped. No soul active in the word of God, in the work of God, starts to feel bored. They used to teach us that when we were kids and teenagers, and we are running around with our little cans doing harvesting, gathering, and we were dressed up there, and some of us thought we would be afraid, but when we went there, folks responded and we were satisfied. They sent us to do Bible studies in the neighborhood and to hand out tracts, and we ran there in all our infantile and juvenile and early adult pomposity. God was able to still use us, and we saw souls brought to the kingdom, brought excitement to our hearts because we were doing the work of God. The souls who had received the Holy Ghost were always engaged in the work of God. Jesus said, all power is given unto you in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end. Pasexousia, the witnessing. Rescue the perishing. Care for the dying. Snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep all the erring ones. Lift up the fallen. Tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Witnessing. Churches who are engaged in prayer, in Bible study and witnessing have souls in them who are alive and happy and enlightened and empowered for the gospel's sake. They're happy to do the work of God in whatever way they can. So the incompletion of the structure makes one vulnerable. Oh, just to make this complete, let me just simply say, Jesus said, listen, I'm here with you always. Always, even unto the end. His power is resident with him. His divine spirit is available to all. There are many things we might want to talk to God about. We might ask him for many things, and very often we wonder if he hears or if he is hearing. But let me be very clear. There is one prayer that God always answers. And the Bible makes it clear. When we pray for the Holy Ghost, if you being evil, Jesus said, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more is your Father, which is in heaven, willing to give the Holy Ghost to those who ask of him? And so if you feel you do not want to do what God wants you to do, remember you can talk to God. He said, delight thyself in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. If you feel he's not hearing you, that is you. God is willing to hear you. We are told by Isaiah, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God. He is willing to remove the iniquity and listen to you. John said, if you say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God is willing to do that. If you're feeling that he would not listen to you, I say God always listens. John reminds us in 5 and verse 14 of 1 John, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. That's the God we serve. If you feel that he intends to do you harm, remember God said, I will visit you and perform good things for you. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you the expected end. This is what God wants to do for us. This is the God we serve. When we are with him, that growth, that perfection is arrived at in our lives by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. If you feel that you cannot find him, God said, and you shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart. Jeremiah 29 and verse 19. If you're feeling that you are not good enough, if you are feeling that God wants to destroy you, that is you, that is not God. Say unto them, the Lord says, as I live, saith the Lord, I have no pleasure at all in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked should turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways and live, for why will you die, O house of Israel? Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse 10. Jeremiah 31 and verse 3 said, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. This is the God we serve. And if you feel you are not getting the victory that you're looking for, remember, God says, I'm willing to give you the victory. This, thus says the Lord, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, I have received thee, I have redeemed thee, I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. This is the God. God we serve. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. This is the God we serve. And sometimes we gotta linger there. We have to linger at his feet, asking him to come through for us. Because if we think he's not coming through, that's us. Our minds are not yet aligned with his desires. We have not yet fully confessed. And if it's not working, that's us. But when you feel something coming through, that is God. For as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. This is the God we serve. God is at work in you. When you feel the victory coming, when the victory is not coming, that is you. At work in you, because you have not yet given up the will to God, to allow God to do his good work in you. For it is God who works in you, both the will and to do of his good pleasure. And so he says here, I said three things that allow us to move to the perfection: prayer, Bible study, and witnessing. You gotta go out to see people, to talk to saints, to talk to the souls struggling along the way. You gotta be connected before you go. You gotta be connected before you go. We read in Acts how some went out there, said, well, in the name of Jesus Christ, whom Paul preacheth, come out of him. The demon beat them until they were almost unconscious. Demon said, Jesus I know and Paul I know. Who are you? I used to hear some of the old preachers tell stories about going to do what in modern day we might call exorcism. They didn't use that word. They used to say, we're going to cast out demons. Somebody in the whole village possessed by the devil, making a mockery of people, and they called the preachers to come preach. And I remember them used to say, if you're doing foolishness, you don't show up, you stay home. You need to pray for your own soul to be right. They were ready. They went out. Demons fled from the presence of ordinary human beings because Jesus was with those human beings who went to confront the soul possessed of the devil. So I'm saying God is at work in you. Hold on, let me close this meeting now. He says, but beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you. Oh, glory to God. He gave them the warning. He gave them the warning. And by the way, before I go on, I read in this here, this inability to experience that renewal came as a result of, this is how I got it together, came as a result of what we might call the permanent falling. Jesus referred to as grieving the Holy Spirit. That's what it is. The one who grieved the Holy Spirit is the one who has continued in his or her evil ways until it finally culminates in an irrevocable decision to go against God and turn the back on Jesus. The waves of mercy beaten back by a rock-hewn heart, returns with stronger force of reconciling love. I'm paraphrasing Ellen White in Desire of Ages. But there comes a day when mercy's effects are no longer felt on this rocky heart. He has chosen to go his own way and walk away from Jesus. That's what happens here. And so the warning is, don't linger in the state of imperfection, of the unfinished business, of the incomplete structure. He said, give them the warning. He said, but I'm delivering you something. God is at work in you. He said, I'm giving you something that I'm confident in. That is, because you have taken on this Jesus. The Jesus who began his good work in you is able to continue it until the day of his coming. Verse 19 says, this hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enters the presence beyond the veil. Oh, glory to God. When you have an opportunity, go home. Read from verse 13. He said, God gave two things. He gave a promise and he signed a pledge. In whose presence did he sign the pledge? In his own presence. He said, the apostle says, there is nobody, there's nothing higher than God. So when God was going to sign the pledge, he signed the pledge in his own presence. Glory to God. Glory to God. So he gave us two things. And so my final observation, Jesus is the guarantee of our completion of the structure. If you have Jesus, you have a guarantee that your structure, your spiritual structure, would be complete. If you have Jesus, you have everything. So he signed the pledge, he made the promise, he signed the pledge. And to fulfill, he sent his son Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ lived. And every now and then I like to remind us all, Jesus Christ came, he was a perfect example here. We did not just need an example. An example is good. We didn't just need an example. We needed a savior. We needed a ransom to be offered in our behalf. We needed somebody to take our sinful lives. We needed somebody to die for us. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. We needed a savior. And when Jesus died in Romans chapter 5, we are told, with his life, by the death of Jesus Christ, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. We are saved by his life, the perfect life. Stay with me. A dead savior is not what we needed. We needed a live savior who had passed through the portals of death. And this writer says, the savior was resurrected. He is in glory. And he, because he died, we died. Because he lived, we live. And because we have hope in him, the hope is secure. In Christ, we have everything. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We have in him our justification, our sanctification, our glorification. He is behind the veil. That is the certain hope that we have. And he called it the anchor of the soul. Jesus is the guarantee of our completion of the structure. It's important for us to be aware of this. Lady, Spurgeon tells the story of a lady, little lady, illiterate old woman, humble follower of the Lamb, skeptical neighbor loved to make fun of her, especially at the assurance that she displayed in her salvation. "How do you know that?" he asked her once. She said, "God tells me 100 times, she answered. And then she quoted the promise after another time when he questioned her. She said, from John's first letter, the epistle of the Christian assurance. He says, we know, the apostle said, she said, apostle used that statement 14 times. So I know because God said it. And then when he realized he couldn't push this lady, he said, well, what if God doesn't keep his word? And she said, well, if he doesn't keep his word, that's too bad. I'll lose, but he will lose more. I will lose my soul, but God will lose his honor. I will lose my soul, but God will lose his honor. When God says, I have you, he means that he has us. And when Jesus said, I'm going to guarantee you, if you allow me to do it in you, he is the guarantee. And so every day, there is something else for us to struggle with. But he is there. I used to like to listen to the Gaither singing and other people sing about one more river to cross, one more mountain to climb, one more valley that I have to go through, leaving my troubles behind. One more battle with the devil. And I know he'll understand. I'm going through with Jesus, hallelujah, holding the nail-scarred hand. One more river cross. So brothers and sisters, we are chasing the horizon. We are never there. In Christ we are complete, but yet incomplete. And when Jesus comes, the process will continue. But right now, our anchor holds within the veil. In Christ, we have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and sure in the Savior's love. Oh, God of heaven, God of heaven, we want to move on to perfection. Indeed, laying the foundation is futile unless the structure is complete. Laying the foundation is not the same as completing the structure. For incompletion of the structure makes us vulnerable. Vulnerable to complete loss of faith, complete erosion of faith. But in Christ, we are guaranteed everything. Everything. And so God, please help that our anchors will hold to Jesus. Amen.